Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon. If I could everybody take a seat, we will get started with this afternoon's briefing. Good afternoon. Welcome, everybody. I'm Dr. Sandra Hernandez, and I'm the CEO at the California Healthcare Foundation. And really, we're quite delighted to have all of you in the room today. For those of you that don't know, the California Healthcare Foundation is a statewide foundation, really focused on healthcare delivery with a very, very intense focus on very low-income communities and people with very complex conditions. Today's convening is one of a regular series of briefings that we sponsor for Sacramento policy staff as well as other individuals. The briefings are designed to bring you information that's relevant and timely to key issues that are being discussed in the state, as well as to promote dialogue on possible solutions to challenges facing our state. In addition to those of you that are in the room, there are about 380 people registered for the live webcast and who are on the phone. And later this week, by the end of the week, the California Healthcare Foundation will post a live video of today's meetings. At all of our briefings, we ask people on their way out at the end of the meeting, what are the other issues and trends for which more information would be relevant? We will do that again today. But over the last many months, and maybe even more than a year, a recurring topic has been behavioral health and really how to understand it, how to think about the trends, and perhaps more importantly, how we as a state can do better. We also hosted a poll earlier this year, and we asked people in the state what their number one healthcare priority was, and it was to make sure that people with mental health problems had access to treatment. Today's briefing focuses specifically on California's public mental health system. Of course, to call it a system is a bit of a misnomer, as everybody knows. In reality, it's a number of different systems, different service organizations provided through counties, through Medi-Cal managed care plans, in our schools, in our prisons, and through a variety of community-based organizations. There are, of course, also multiple funding streams. It can be very complicated to understand what it does, how it does it, how the pieces fit together, and what the big issues are. So we thought today it would be helpful to try to give an orientation to all of us. The centerpiece, of course, of this multidimensional system is Medi-Cal. It provides the largest source of public funding for mental health. It covers the full range of acuity from treatment for very common conditions like depression or anxiety to specialty mental health care for people with serious persistent mental illness. And at the same time, Medi-Cal, of course, covers physical health and substance use disorder treatments. One of the very, very big issues that keeps us up at night is whether and how these different types of care are coordinated and integrated to make it easy for people with mental health needs to access them. We're very lucky in California, in many ways, to have a dedicated stream of mental health funding through the Mental Health Services Act of 2004. These revenues, $2 billion alone in 2017-18, mostly go directly to counties for community services, for prevention, and for early intervention, as well as other services. This is a funding source that offers us significant flexibility, and it also adds, of course, to the complexity of the system. Given that this is a topic of such great importance in California, it's important that we all have a shared understanding of what it is today and how it works, and that's why we are here today. We're very honored to have a stellar group of speakers who Catherine will introduce in a moment, but before we do that, I wanted to take a moment to specifically thank DHCS Director Jennifer Kent, both for being with us today, for her leadership over the last many years as we expanded Medi-Cal to serving 13 million people in California, and for her leadership in particular for the creation of a new organized delivery system for people with substance use disorders. So very special thank you for Jennifer for being with us today and for her long tenured service. And now, without further ado, I'd like to turn the program over to Catherine Teer. She's our Associate Director for High Value Care at the Foundation. She's going to serve as the MC for our briefing today. She'll cover a few brief topics and then introduce the panel. Thank you and welcome to all of you. Catherine.
Thank you, Sandra, and welcome everyone. We are very happy to have so many of you here and so many of you joining us online for this event. I'm going to give a quick overview of our agenda, let you know who our speakers are, although they won't mostly be coming up for a little bit, and then talk a little bit about some basics of mental health and mental illness in California. So first, our speakers. We are very lucky to have an all-star roster today. After me, you'll hear from Adriana Ramos-Yamamoto from the California Budget and Policy Center, who's going to provide a high-level overview of the governance, financing, and organization of California's public mental health system. Then we're going to switch places, and the rest of our panel will come up. We'll hear from Jennifer Kent, Director of the California Department of Healthcare Services, about how the Affordable Care Act has changed the landscape for public mental health over the last 5 years. We'll be joined by Michelle Cabrera, Executive Director of the County Behavioral Health Directors Association, who's going to give us the county view, how things look for the personnel who manage multiple funding streams and programmatic responsibilities to bring services to people in their communities. And finally, Sarah Arnquist, Vice President of Client Partnerships at Beacon Health Options, will talk about the role of managed behavioral health organizations in California's system. And we will have plenty of time after that for your questions and their answers. I want to expand a little bit on Sandra's comments on why the California Healthcare Foundation thinks that we all need to better understand this complex system in California. Many of you are well aware that from the Capitol to our neighborhoods, mental health policy is a topic of frequent, maybe constant, conversation. Sometimes the discussion is about the difficulty of accessing services. In the 10 minutes before this briefing started, I had that conversation with two of you already. Sometimes it's about the intersection between homelessness and mental illness, or about jails and prisons, or the educational system. And in all these contexts, we're talking about mental health more, and that's a very good thing. We also have more money in the mental health care system than we have in the past, and Adriana will describe that in more detail in a few minutes. How we manage that money and what it's used for is also a frequent topic that we're grappling with on the state and local levels. And finally, we're seeing lots of innovation in the healthcare delivery system, including work to integrate mental health care and physical health care, and new treatment options for people at all levels of acuity. But it can be challenging to figure out who pays for these services and how they're delivered, and that's another reason we need to understand the system that we have. But all of these things, policy, financing, delivery system, are in the service of providing high quality care so that people can be well and participate in their communities. And so I now want to take a step back and talk a little bit high level about mental illness and mental health in California. A New York Times article reported last year that Americans with serious mental illness live shorter lives than those in many of the world's poorest countries. And here are the statistics. People with serious mental illness die 25 years earlier than people without. People with substance use disorder, almost the same statistic. And for the most part, people die not from the causes that some might think are linked to those illnesses, to their mental illnesses in particular, like suicide or overdose, but rather from the same things that other people die from just a lot earlier. According to a Kaiser study, people with a serious mental illness are 2 to 4 times as likely to have chronic physical health conditions like heart disease, diabetes, respiratory illness, obesity, hepatitis C, chronic pain, as people without serious mental illness. So those are national data. We actually don't have that for California, I should say. But I'm going to go on to talk about a number of California statistics about prevalence. Most of these were published in our Almanac publication last year on mental health and mental health care. It's available at the back of the room and on our website. A lot of this data that I'm going to present is from 2014, 2015. It's the most recent we had. But there have been some important changes since then, including California's expansion of Medi-Cal eligibility and implementation of other parts of the Affordable Care Act and mental health parity laws. So keep that in mind. And of course, data like this do a good job of painting an overall picture, but not a very good job of representing individuals' successes and challenges in the system. So keep that in mind as well. The first thing that I want you all to be very aware of is that mental illnesses are common chronic conditions, very common. In 2014 in California, 1 in 24 adults, about 4%, experienced a serious mental illness. And that's defined as a diagnosable mental, behavioral, or emotional disorder. Adriana's also going to talk a little bit more about definitions in a minute. A much larger percentage, about 1 in 6 Californians, 15%, experienced any mental illness. In other words, they had a mental, behavioral, or emotional disorder, regardless of the level of impairment they experienced. Among children, that's the green line at the bottom, 17 or younger, 1 in 13 had a serious emotional disturbance. And again, that's a disorder that limits functioning in family, school, or community activities. And for the most part, and I'll be saying this a few more times, the overall estimates and the estimates for subpopulations have not changed significantly, or in some cases at all, since the last time we pulled these data, and that was based on 2009 data. So again, these are consistent because, as I say, these are common illnesses. In both children and adults, mental illness, either serious emotional disturbance for children, serious mental illness for adults, is far more common at the lowest income levels. From the green bars, that's children again, you can see that 1 in 10 children below the poverty level suffered from a serious emotional disturbance. This is 2014 again. The orange bars show that almost as many adults, 9%, below the federal poverty level had serious mental illness. Rates also vary some across the state by region. The rate of serious emotional disturbance in children in California varied from a high of 8.1 in the San Joaquin Valley to a low of 7.1 in the Bay Area. Again, the average is 7.6. So there's some variation around that average number. For adults, that's the orange bars, the range was from a high of 5.4% of people experiencing serious mental illness in Northern and Sierra region to a low of 3.4% in the Greater Bay Area. I didn't include these slides, but again, for adults, California women were more likely than men to experience serious mental illness, about close to 5% versus under 4%. And again, these numbers have not changed since 2009. I want to say we're focusing, as you know, on the mental health system today, but I would be remiss in not saying something about substance use disorder. Very frequently, people with mental illness also experience substance use disorder. The statistics here show about a third of adults with serious mental illness also have diagnosed substance use disorder. For youth, that number is about 9%. And these numbers probably understate the rate of co-occurrence. I wanted to make a quick aside, since we are trying to get everyone to the same level, about terminology. You will hear us sometimes today in other places talk about mental health and substance use together as behavioral health. And you may have noticed that in many communities, as well as at the state level, programs that used to be separate, mental health programs, substance use disorder, or drug and alcohol programs, have now come together and are really behavioral health programs or behavioral health departments, and that's true at the provider level too. Turning now to treatment quickly. I said earlier that mental illnesses are common chronic conditions. While for some people, mental illness is a lifelong experience, a lifelong condition. Most mental illnesses can be managed through treatment. Unfortunately, not enough Californians are receiving that treatment. And by and large, again, the situation has not changed since 2009. As you can see here on this slide, just over a third of California adults with a mental illness receive treatment or counseling during the previous year. That's about 5% below what the national rate is, which is already quite low. On the positive side, access is better for adults who report a major depressive episode. Nearly two-thirds of that group did receive treatment, and that's important to say. As you know, depression is one of the most common forms of mental illness. It's associated with a higher risk of suicide and also a higher risk of cardiovascular death. I've said, and it was true for the last slide, that many rates have not changed significantly since 2009, but there are some differences, and this is one. Adolescents with major depression, both prevalence rates are up and treatment levels are really very low. The rates of major depressive episodes for adolescents have increased dramatically. 10 years ago, about 8% of teens reported experiencing a major depressive episode. In 2014-15, that rate was 12%, over 12%, or 1 in 8 California adolescents. So an increase of 50% over just a few years, about 6 years. And unfortunately, again, on average, between 2011 and 2015, only about a third of California adolescents with a major depressive episode received treatment. Again, lower than the national average, which is already low. So I hope that these quick statistics, and I have many more, and you can find them on our website, give you a sense of the challenge that California's system faces, as well as the tremendous opportunity we have to bring effective treatment to people across all regions of the state, across all age groups, and all levels of acuity of their illness. And I'm delighted now to turn the mic over to Adriana Ramos-Yamamoto from the California Budget and Policy Center for the next phase of the presentation. Adriana.
Thank you, Catherine, for the introduction and to the California Healthcare Foundation for putting on this event. As Catherine mentioned, my name is Adriana. I'm representing the California Budget and Policy Center today. And if you're not familiar with our organization, we engage in independent state fiscal and policy analysis and public education with the goal of improving public policies that affect the social and economic well-being of low and middle-income Californians. Thanks to the California Healthcare Foundation, we are actually going to be publishing a longer, more comprehensive chart book, as well as other materials in the coming months, so please stay tuned for those. But this is a great opportunity for us to share with you all what we have as we continue to do more research on this important topic. Today, I will provide a high-level overview of the public mental health system in California, including the entities that administer and oversee public mental health services, the service delivery system, funding for public mental health services, and I will also talk about recent funding trends. And just to note, I'm talking about publicly funded mental health services that are provided primarily through Medi-Cal and in community settings. So we're not going to be talking about services provided through private insurance, for instance. And there are some publicly funded mental health services that are excluded from this overview, such as school-based mental health services, services for children and youth in foster care, and services for incarcerated adults. And lastly, I want to emphasize that this is a high-level overview, so a lot of technical and historical details will be left out of this presentation. So with that being said, let's dive in. Starting with governance and oversight, we know that the state's public mental health system is governed by federal, state, and local entities. These are the entities at the various levels who have oversight responsibility. And while these are listed in three separate boxes, there's a lot of communication and coordination that happens between the various levels, so these are not siloed by any means. On the federal level, the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services oversees California's Medicaid program, which, as you know, we refer to as Medi-Cal. The Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration, SAMHSA, monitors the state administration of block grant funding for mental health services. The Department of Healthcare Services, DHCS, oversees and administers Medi-Cal and the Medi-Cal Specialty Mental Health Services Program. DHCS shares responsibilities for policy development, implementation, and oversight for the broader public mental health system with the Mental Health Services Oversight and Accountability Commission and the California Behavioral Health Planning Council. The Mental Health Services Oversight and Accountability Commission is a 16-member commission that oversees the provision of services under the Mental Health Services Act, which I will talk about later on in this presentation. The Behavioral Health Planning Council reviews and reports on the public behavioral health system, participates in statewide planning, and advises the legislature on priority issues. And on the county level, the boards of supervisors oversee local mental health programs with input from local mental health advisory boards. The state's public mental health system provides services to many individuals, and you may be wondering how many individuals receive public mental health services. While we currently do not have that exact number due to data limitations, we know that there are about 720,000 individuals, that's about 308,000 children and youth, and 412,000 adults projected to receive specialty mental health services this year. And I'm going to talk about that more shortly. But essentially, this is just a subset of public mental health services, not all services. And before I dive into the system overview, I want to talk about medical necessity criteria for mental health conditions. The first one, mild to moderate, is not a clinical term. It is a Medi-Cal definition that applies to mental health conditions that result in mild to moderate distress or impairment of mental, emotional, or behavioral functioning. Serious emotional disturbance is a categorization for children and youth 17 and under who currently have, or at some point during the past year, have had a mental, behavioral, or emotional disorder resulting in functional impairment that substantially limits functioning in family, school, or community activities. And the last, serious mental illness. This is a categorization for adults who currently have, or during the past year, have had a diagnosable mental, behavioral, or emotional disorder resulting in functional impairment that interferes with major life activities. And I want to note that there are differences between adults and children in terms of medical necessity, and I'm going to come back to that point later on in this presentation. Okay, so this is a general overview of the public mental health system. As you can see, services are provided through Medi-Cal managed care plans and fee-for-service Medi-Cal, and through the counties, primarily through county mental health plans. While counties have historically provided most Medi-Cal mental health services in the state, other services have become available through Medi-Cal managed care health plans since California expanded the scope of mental health benefits available to Medi-Cal beneficiaries in 2014 as a result of the Affordable Care Act implementation. And I also want to note that there is some coordination that often occurs between managed care and counties. And I'm not going to elaborate on that, but the only thing that I'll say on that before moving on is that coordination among these different delivery systems is a work in progress. As you saw in the previous slide, Medi-Cal managed care plans and fee-for-service Medi-Cal provide mental health services to Medi-Cal beneficiaries with mild to moderate mental health conditions. About 10.8 million Medi-Cal beneficiaries receive their health care through managed care. And a little bit about how it works. In the managed care delivery system, typically the state pays a contracted health plan a fixed capitated payment amount for each enrolled beneficiary. Managed care plans are then responsible for providing the services. And in the fee-for-service delivery model, the state pays the healthcare provider for each administered state plan service. And among the services provided are services within a primary care provider scope of practice, psychotherapy, psychological testing, and medication management. So now on to the counties. Counties provide services for individuals experiencing an SED or SMI. And again, that's a serious emotional disturbance or serious mental illness. So counties are responsible for Medi-Cal specialty mental health services, Mental Health Services Act programs, and safety net mental health services for low-income Californians without health coverage. And I'm going to be talking more about these programs in just a moment. But I want to point out that counties deliver services through county-owned and county-operated facilities, and they also contract with hospitals, clinics, private practitioners, and so on to provide these services. Okay, so starting with Medi-Cal Specialty Mental Health Services. These services, as you may know, are carved out of the broader Medi-Cal program and are administered by DHCS under the federal waiver, the 1915B waiver, that is approved by the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, CMS. DHCS also contracts with mental health plans in each county to provide or arrange for the provision of Medi-Cal Specialty Mental Health Services. And as we discussed earlier, Medi-Cal beneficiaries must meet medical necessity criteria, and a little bit more on that. As I mentioned earlier, there's a difference between children and adults. Children's specialty mental health services are provided under the federal requirements of the Early and Periodic Screening, Diagnosis, and Treatment Benefit, EPSDT, which is available to full-scope beneficiaries under the age of 21. So for children and youth under EPSDT, the impairment criteria component of specialty mental health services, the medical necessity criteria is less stringent than it is for adults. So children with low levels of impairment may meet medical necessity criteria for specialty mental health services. And services include therapy, crisis intervention and stabilization, psychiatric services, and day treatment and rehabilitation. So moving on to the Mental Health Services Act programs, which came about as a result of Prop 63 in 2004. Prop 63 created a 1% surtax on personal incomes above $1 million to provide increased funding for mental health services. A small percentage of funding stays at the state level, but the majority goes to counties, and counties have some flexibility in how to use these funds, but the MHSA specifies five required components, which are listed here. So the first being community services and supports. This involves the funding of direct services to individuals. Capital, facilities, and technological needs relates to building projects and improvement of mental health services delivery by increasing technological capacity. Workforce, education, and training includes funds to improve the capacity of the mental health workforce. Prevention and early intervention relates to outreach programs for families and providers to recognize early signs of mental illness. And innovation includes the funding and evaluation of new approaches to increase access to underserved communities, to promote interagency collaboration, and to increase the overall quality of mental health services. So in addition to specialty mental health services and MHSA programs, counties provide safety net mental health services to uninsured Californians with an SED or SMI. And services are similar to Medi-Cal specialty mental health services and are provided to the extent that resources are available. And I also want to note, counties also provide crisis services to all residents regardless of insurance status. So even those with private insurance, for instance, can receive crisis services. So far, I've talked about who oversees public mental health services and how those services are delivered. Now I'm going to shift gears and talk about funding for public mental health services which, as you may know, comes from multiple sources. This is a general overview of California's public mental health system and funding. As you can see, we have federal funds, state general funds, realignment funds, and mental health services funds flowing to Medi-Cal and to the counties. Now I'm going to talk more about these funds specifically. From the federal level, California receives funding support through Medicaid and the Community Mental Health Services Block Grant, which SAMHSA administers. The state provides funding support through 1991 and 2011 realignment, which I will talk more about in a short moment. The state also provides funding through the MHSA, which again is Prop 63, and through the State General Fund. And counties also use their own funds to support mental health services. On realignment, very briefly, realignment is the transfer of administrative and financial control from the state to the counties. And California underwent two major realignments in 1991 and in 2011 that affected mental health program responsibilities. Prior to realignment, county mental health programs competed for funding made available through the annual state budget appropriations process. In 1991, the legislature enacted a major realignment of health and social services programs, funding, and responsibilities. As a result, counties are responsible for providing services to individuals with an SED or SMI. And to pay for the shift in services, the state raised revenues. It provides counties with a portion of the revenue from a state sales tax and with a portion of revenue from vehicle license fees. So that's 1991. On 2011, the realignment package was implemented through a series of bills tied to the State Budget Act. It included various criminal justice, mental health, drug and alcohol, and social services programs. The 2011 realignment completed the transfer of funding and responsibility for public mental health services from the state to the counties. And one other important policy to mention before moving on is Prop 30, which was passed by voters in November 2012. Prop 30 added constitutional protections to the 2011 realignment funding structure. It essentially prohibits the state from passing any new laws that increase county costs without providing additional funding. Okay, and for the purposes of the rest of this presentation, we're only going to be talking about these specific funds, which are Medicaid, the block grant funding, 1991 and 2011 realignment, and the MHSA. This is a snapshot of funding for public mental health services in the fiscal year 2017-2018. As you can see, more than half of funding comes from the state. Realignment provided $2.8 billion, which is about 36% of the total funding reflected here, while the MHSA provided $2 billion. The state received approximately $3 billion from Medicaid and $74.2 million from SAMHSA through the Community Mental Health Services Block Grant. And I also want to point out, this does not include funding for managed care, which the LAO estimates to be an additional $1.9 billion. On to funding trends. Funding for the state's public mental health services has increased in recent years. This graph shows the change in state and federal funding since the fiscal year 2012-2013, adjusted for inflation. The funding sources I just mentioned are aggregated here in this line. And as you can see, public mental health funding in California is on the rise. Since 2012, funding has increased by about 35%. This is largely due to the Affordable Care Act implementation, when California, as I mentioned earlier, expanded the availability of mental health benefits in Medi-Cal. Starting in 2014, managed care plans took an expanded role in delivering mental health services to their enrollees. And as a result, the Medicaid contribution increased significantly. But there has also been some growth in realignment funding and MHSA funding as well. So with that, I will conclude here, but before I leave, I'd like to pose some questions for you all to think about, and maybe you have been already. And that is, do we need more funding for public mental health services? Is there more that the state can do to ensure that all Californians receive the mental health services that they need in order to thrive? And if so, what are the policy solutions that are currently on the table? Of course, there's a lot more to be discussed on this topic, and I look forward to hearing from the other panelists here today. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Adriana. That was a spectacular overview and really puts us, I think, in a great position for our panel. So I'd like to invite our other panelists, Jennifer, Sarah, and Michelle, all to come up and join us at the table. Oh, good. I could only see one of them for a while, so I'm glad to see everyone's here. And while they're coming up and getting settled, I'll just do a little bit of housekeeping. Just so everyone's aware, there's stairs over here. We're going to hold all questions until after these three panelists have spoken, at which point Adriana is going to join us back up here, and we'll be able to take questions from the audience for all four. As Sandra mentioned earlier, Adriana's slides, my slides, and a number of other supporting materials will be up on our website by the end of the week, along with a recording of this entire event. So if people want to watch it again, or if you came in late, you will have another chance. And finally, in case I forget to say it later, as you heard, we really do pay attention to our evaluations. And so I do hope you will fill out that, I think it's a green sheet today, that's in your packets. So with that, I'm going to take comments from our panelists in the order in which they're seated. And so Jennifer, we'll turn to you first. Would love to hear thoughts in general, but particularly how things look from the department and what's changed in the last 5 years since the ACA implementation.
Sure, great. So thank you very much. I would say, you know, when the Affordable Care Act was enacted and implemented in the state of California, I think for a lot of reasons, people were most excited about what expansion meant for single childless adults. When you think back before the Affordable Care Act, you had a lot of challenges with people being able to access coverage. And you heard certainly about that in the news media around you had a pre-existing condition, your employer didn't offer coverage, you were unable to afford it. And I think the ACA really sought to address all of that. But in Medicaid, one of the most persistent populations that had eluded a lot of states were the single childless adults. And so when we implemented that in the state of California for the first time, you had individuals that we knew had significant behavioral health challenges. And I will certainly use Catherine's term throughout my conversation today, because for many of us in the state, we believe that a lot of individuals have co-occurring disorders between mental health and substance use. So I will use behavioral health just to basically stand in place of mental health alone. And I think the Affordable Care Act, for the first time, really allowed this population to have access to full comprehensive health benefits. As noted briefly in the previous presentation, we oversee 6 delivery systems within the state. And so when someone is found eligible for Medi-Cal, they're enrolled into managed care by and large, and that is where the bulk of their services are. But if they have a mental health issue that is beyond mild to moderate, they do seek services through the county mental health plan. If they have a substance use disorder, they also can seek services through the county. Each county, from a substance use disorder standpoint, has 2 different delivery systems, either what we call state plan drug Medi-Cal services or there are a number of counties that have opted into our drug Medi-Cal organized delivery system waiver, in which that is a more comprehensive substance use set of services, and that is at the county's option for the reasons stated prior around Prop 30. But you have individuals that can use 1, 2, 3 systems. They also can use, obviously, our dental system. They may or may not be receiving services through regional centers or through IHSS. Those are all separate delivery systems that we oversee at the state. But for purposes of this, you had individuals, and we think around 4 million were enrolled, and that's how much our program grew from the time that we implemented to where we are approximately today. Caseload has dropped over the last couple of years. If you've paid attention to our enrollment, this is primarily due to the fact that California's economy and the unemployment rate are significantly down from when we did implement the Affordable Care Act. But I think that obviously the coverage expansion was one of the most critical components for helping individuals receive services. And we were very proud of the drug Medi-Cal organized delivery system waiver because it was the first in the country to offer a full complement of SUD services for individuals up to and including residential treatment. So we were one of the first states to really craft a benefit that was complete in its ability to try to address some of these underlying concerns. One of the other issues that we at the state have both implemented and is available on our website is we had to do a parity analysis to compare our benefits in Medi-Cal managed care and all of our delivery systems as to whether or not there was parity for purposes of physical health services versus mental health and behavioral health services. And so by and large, there were not significant issues identified in our parity analysis. There was one quantitative treatment limitation, which we had to make changes to around ESPRT. ESPRT stands for Screening, Brief, Intervention, Referral, and Treatment. So this is a tool used to assess patients when they come into either a primary care or perhaps into an emergency room where a provider can evaluate them and say, do you appear to have a problem with substance use? And the idea is that you are trying to capture people at a moment in which they are receptive to that that brief intervention and then get them into longer term referrals and treatment. So our parity analysis showed that we had to make some changes around the use of that particular screening tool. And then the rest of our parity analysis that we conducted in the state was really around non-quantitative treatment limitations. So did we have processes in place that were more restrictive on the mental health, county behavioral health side than we did on the physical health managed care side? And I think the counties would agree when I say this, is I think one of the biggest changes was around the concurrent authorization of inpatient services as opposed to them being retrospective. And so those were some of the changes that we had to make according to the parity work. And then we have ongoing monitoring and compliance aspects with the purposes of that federal rule. The increase of the optional benefit expansion for mild to moderate services back in January of 2014, like everything in Medi-Cal, when we add new benefits, there is a ramp up time for both beneficiaries to know that that service is available, for providers to be aware that they can offer that service and how they get reimbursed for it, or in some cases for the plans to contract with those providers in order to have that network be as robust as necessary. For the past several years, we have been doing some dashboards and data around the use of mild to moderate services in our program compared to adults and youth that use what we call short Doyle services. Short Doyle is the claim system by which the counties submit claims for specialty mental health services in the state. They submit a claim to us, we draw down the federal matching funds and send it back to the counties. So that's our shorthand way of when someone is seeking specialty mental health services, we're like, oh, that's the short Doyle system as opposed to the managed care system. And so I brought a couple of these data charts just to kind of show the growth in the use of mild to moderate benefits since we put it in 2014. So back in 2014, there was approximately 101,000 adults that used exclusively mild to moderate services, while 255,000 adults use the short Doyle specialty mental health services, and a very small slice use both, about 13,000 individuals. And then what's been interesting is, as you've looked over fiscal years, how those numbers have slightly changed. And so if you go to 2015-2016, instead of 101,000 adults using mild to moderate, it went up to 147,000. You go to 2016-17, it went to 188,000. And in 17-18, which is the last year that we have data for right now, it went up to 210,000. So as you can see, the more that the benefit has both been in place and the more that providers are aware that it's in use and that beneficiaries are aware, you will continue to see enhanced growth in that mild to moderate benefit. For children, the numbers are smaller, and again, that's because, based on the presentation before, there are different standards in place for children seeking behavioral health services under the EPSDT benefit. It is a lot more open and flexible. It is certainly less stringent than the medical necessity determinations that adults have. But back in 2014-15, 37,000 children used mild to moderate benefits. That grew to 54,000 in 15-16, grew to 74,000 in 16-17, and in 17-18, it's around 91,000 using mild to moderate. On the specialty mental health side, children use, there's about 245,000 unique individuals that use it. So you can see that there's still a pretty dramatic difference between the pediatric population and the adult population. And then, not to be outdone, the federal government issued a significant change to managed care regulation back in 2016 that had a extensive impact on the county mental health plans in California and everywhere else in the country. But we have 56 county mental health plans that we contract with today. And for the first time, based on that federal rule, starting in 2018, each county mental health plan had to submit certain documents and certain filings with us, as similar to what our managed care plans file with us on the physical health side. And so this managed care rule was certainly one of the more notable changes in the contractual requirements that the counties have to meet in order to provide these services. They're now held to network adequacy standards, to timely access standards, to time and distance standards, and they have to file these networks with us every year. We have to certify them to the federal government, and then there's ongoing monitoring and compliance and a lot of other regulations and changes that came about as part of that rule. I think that in some cases it's both good and bad. Good from the standpoint that if you can't see it, you can't measure it. If you can't measure it, you can't improve upon it. And certainly that is something that we are committed to doing in partnership with the counties, especially as we approach our next 11-15 and 19-15 waiver renewals. But the network filings and stuff really also demonstrated that the compliance aspects within each county are certainly significant. Some of our smaller counties are certainly not able to fully staff in the way that a big sophisticated managed care plan would be. And so that has certainly been one of the more challenging aspects of the implementation of the federal managed care rule, which I think we are still continuing to work through with the counties on a regular basis. But for that, I think I will stop and defer off to the counties.
Great. See, is this on? Yes, it is. Hi, good afternoon or morning. Michelle Cabrera with the County Behavioral Health Directors Association. And first, I want to thank CHCF and Catherine for setting up this panel today. I think we are living in a moment, not just in the policy sphere, not just in Sacramento, but I think more broadly, culturally, of understanding the importance of both mental illness as well as substance use disorders. And it's a welcome sort of acknowledgement in our culture, because we have a long way to go to start to dismantle the stigma that still permeates our society, and then how care is delivered and how we can best assist people living with mental illness and substance use disorders. And I think, you know, in terms of that mix, I just want to again thank Catherine for pointing out that it's difficult to talk about mental illness in isolation. One of the things that I've heard from our county behavioral health directors is that sometimes when someone walks in the door, it's hard to tell what's going on entirely on day one. If that person is, you know, for example, undergoing meth-induced psychosis, and as a clinician, you're supposed to figure out, well, what's the co-occurring mental illness that goes along with that, and make a decision about that right off the top. It's really hard to know sometimes until you start to peel back the layers of addiction, to the extent that person is willing, what level of mental illness is underneath that, and what kind of course of action will be most important. And this is all to say that in when we're talking about behavioral health in policy circles, we really are talking about, in addressing it, a biopsychosocial model of care. And it's really important for us to remember that for us, the goal is not just sort of, you know, figuring out the right dosage of certain medications or even a course of treatment. Oftentimes, what county behavioral health is asking itself is, how do I help guide this person to finding purpose in life? And I think oftentimes our systems are set up to when they're working at their best, to ask, you know, how can we work together in a client-directed way for our clients to figure out for themselves, what is living my best life look like? And so in that way, treatment planning and services and engagement, all of that looks incredibly different in the, you know, when you're oriented around a psychosocial rehabilitative model of recovery for people. And so I'm just going to get into a little bit about some of the ways in which you know, for me as a policy nerd, I am just delighted that the behavioral health space is so different. So starting out, counties have responsibility for administering services for individuals throughout the lifespan. And again, this goes to that sort of purpose life kind of mission. We work with individuals in early childhood all the way through to end of life. And sometimes someone living their best life is being a part of our system until the end of their life. The Medi-Cal portion of our population is, of course, the biggest, the largest spend that we have. It's far more significant in terms of prevalence, as you saw up on the map. And for that, yes, we cover specialty mental health. I think of us as the specialty delivery system for people with serious mental illness. But then within the children's population, we definitely go broader and we capture more children, fortunately. I think from a public health standpoint, that makes a lot of sense. And particularly given the fact that education levels are much lower for individuals with serious mental illness, and that impacts their ability to find employment later in life. And I think probably is part of the reason why for our seriously mental ill population, you'll see a lot more people who are low income living with serious mental illness. It's very difficult unless you're, you know, in a better place to have those sort of foundational education levels that help you to get good jobs, et cetera. On the outside of Medi-Cal, what I think is fascinating is that counties have responsibility both for uninsured populations and many times for people with private coverage as well. And so you can think about us as having obligation to serve, and this is beyond Medi-Cal, anyone, regardless of payer, any kind of insurance, when they're in a mental health crisis. And then to the extent that we have grants, either through SAMHSA, Prop 47, AB 109, or SAPD grants, for example, MHSA can fall into this bucket. To the extent that the resources are available, we're also reaching people with private coverage or with no coverage at all. And I think sometimes this is where we really feel this rub with county behavioral health or our public behavioral health system, because we are some things to some people and all things to others, right? And the services do vary based on whether your local jurisdiction went after a certain grant and got a certain grant, or whether you're funded to certain levels. And that's for a variety of different populations. And then within those categorical pots of funding, we are funding a full continuum of services, from prevention, everything like suicide prevention, to early identification and intervention, assessment, treatment, rehabilitation services, case management. County Behavioral Health is really good at case management. And then the full service partnership model, which is the bulk of the MHSA funds, which really drives the whatever it takes model of care. And I would say, to the funding story presented earlier, you know, as I have looked at the MHSA and talked with county directors, there is no part of the services that I just mentioned that isn't really fully supported by the MHSA. It is core to all of our programs. By our recent estimates, leveraging close to $1 billion in federal financial participation through Medi-Cal also helps support step downs and our crisis continuum. So those 5150s and gravely disabled, the Laura's Law type outreach. And it also funds all of our prevention and early intervention work in our school partnerships. So as you can imagine, it just keeps popping up everywhere as this incredibly important source of funding for our public behavioral health system. The other thing that is kind of a unique feature of county behavioral health is that we are, yes, health plans, as Jennifer mentioned, you know, subject to the federal final rule. And we are also direct service providers, unlike many of our Medi-Cal managed care counterparts. And so counties, to varying levels, depending on the region, either directly serve individuals in some of our more rural, smaller counties. I'll even have county behavioral health directors who see clients themselves. To other regions where, for example, in Alameda, the system is largely contracted providers. And then our services are not, you know, tied to the four walls of the clinic. Our services really are mobile. We are out in communities. We are in individuals' homes. And it's really sort of that high touch in community level of engagement with a very wide range of providers, from peers all the way through to psychiatrists. There are obviously a lot of things that we could do better to improve on the workforce, and that's maybe a topic for another day. I did just want to touch on two pieces of the services that we deliver outside of Medi-Cal, which obviously touch the Medi-Cal population but are not exclusive to. One is the involuntary treatment set of services that counties provide. We're responsible for individuals who fall under the Lantrum and Petras Short Act. So again, these are our gravely disabled 5150s, regardless of payer source, inpatient hospitalizations for these individuals in state hospitals, our institutes for mental disease placements, conservatorships, as well as forensic conservatorships, Laura's Law, in jail treatment, in individual substance use disorders or in jail, and then for our incompetent to stand trial, as well as specialty court populations. On the homeless end, we actually fund a variety of both housing as well as housing supports and services for homeless individuals. We have homeless outreach teams and crisis mobile teams. We have been a part of the whole person care pilots and provide a variety of sort of street treatment as well as the full service partnerships. And then payment patches to board and care. And I would say that within, for example, the MHSA full service partnership model, whether those are directly related to homelessness or not, our services do a ton to prevent homelessness to the extent that we are housing individuals and helping them to stay housed through the FSP model, and then also again in our board and care facilities. And so think of us as the safety net. I think that there's a robust conversation to be had about what exists on the other side of that safety net. And to Adriana's question earlier, yes, I think more money is needed, because for as much as we are able to do with the available funding sources, the needs are obviously far greater than what we currently are able to do. And it is across multiple populations. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Sarah Arnquist, and I'm a Vice President of Account Partnerships with Beacon. Thank you to the Foundation for inviting me to present today. I live in the Bay Area. So Beacon is a national company. We're a national specialty behavioral health organization. We work in 50 states and serve about 45 million individuals across those states, including 13 million Medicaid or publicly insured individuals in about 25 states. And local here in the area, we're going to kind of talk about our role in the public mental health system, where we contract with 8 of the Medi-Cal managed care plans to deliver these mild to moderate benefits that you all have heard about. That represents about 3 million beneficiaries in 25 counties from San Diego to Humboldt. We are not a direct provider of services. We are more like an insurance company that contracts with providers. And so we have a network of 7,000 independent clinicians in these counties to provide services. We also have contracts directly with some counties to provide administrative services on their behalf. These are usually very specific functions, such as providing an outpatient psychiatry network that wraps around their network, or doing inpatient utilization management. One important similarity in both of these situations is that we are a subdelegate to that county or to that plan to perform specific functions. The health plan or county contracting with us remains in control, setting the clinical priorities and performance expectations. We are accountable to them, and they are accountable to their state regulators. So I want to dive a little bit deeper into what exactly these mild to moderate benefits are. They are specifically individual therapy, group therapy, medication management, and psychological testing. The plans also are responsible for paying for some of the pharmacy benefits. They must be rendered by a licensed clinician or a waivered intern working under supervision of a licensed clinician. They are part of the essential health benefits of the Affordable Care Act, which were established from a benchmark plan. Each state had to have a benchmark plan. California's benchmark plan was Kaiser's commercial small group HMO plan. And so these mild to moderate benefits really mimic sort of what is available in a commercial benefit today. They are much more of a medical-oriented benefit. So unlike Michelle described, all of the social rehabilitative option services that are available through counties, and which are very appropriate and needed for individuals with mental illness, on the Medi-Cal managed care plan side, it's a much more defined benefit set. So over the 5 years, Jen already talked about how utilization has been increasing as the plans, as more individuals are aware of the benefit and the networks have expanded. Last year, Beacon, about 140,000 individuals, adults and children, access services through Beacon's network. And in most counties, we have seen that increase year over year and expect it to continue. But it shouldn't be a surprise that utilization is closely tied to network access, and there are pockets throughout the state where network access remains challenging. To address that, telehealth is a key tool to kind of redistribute the provider networks from areas where there are more to areas where there are less. And we continue to invest here. Our Medi-Cal plan partners, by and large, have embraced this as an important modality, and we expect that utilization to continue to increase.
Splitting the service delivery between the counties and the plans on impairment level necessitates that there be collaboration across the two entities or three entities. And that collaboration has to be described in MOUs that each plan and county has. The MOUs describe how referrals will be tracked, individuals will be stepped up and stepped down, and to make sure that everyone is screened to the appropriate level of care. So in 2018, Beacon screened about 60,000 individuals. More than 90% stay at the mild to moderate level. And then with each county, we sort of track who goes back and forth. Individual willingness to collaborate and do what's right for beneficiaries is steadfast. But there are structural barriers of splitting the system that do challenge even the best of intentions. And so I'm going to give a case study example that illustrates some of these challenges. So let's use the example of a middle-aged woman who's experiencing depression or anxiety. She goes to her primary care provider who prescribes an antidepressant and recommends she seek out therapy. So she calls the number on the back of her Medi-Cal health plan card, and on the other end, someone answers, and then she undergoes a screening to see is she mild to moderate or is she moderate to severe. Beacon works in 25 counties, and not one of these counties has the same process for coordinating these referrals or the criteria for acceptance. So that means the same individual with the same symptoms may be accepted into services in one county, but won't be accepted into services in another county. But let's just assume that she's mild to moderate, and so she goes into a Beacon contracted therapist for services. So she's in therapy, and then her symptoms escalate, and she, you know, different life stressors happen, and she is suddenly much more severely depressed and suicidal. Now she is hospitalized. And at this point, the county takes over and manages, whether that be an involuntary or voluntary hospitalization. And so her primary care provider, her Beacon therapist, Beacon, and her health plan don't know she's been hospitalized because she's now sort of on that side. When she's ready to discharge, she may go into the county system now, which offers a really, you know, pretty robust set of services to help her stay stable. But she may also be discharged back to her Beacon therapist, and which is great for continuity of care, but she doesn't now have access to those psychosocial issues, you know, extra services that may help address her psychosocial issues, which are really important to help one stay at the moderate level. In April of this year, Beacon began working with a Northern California county to manage inpatient mental health utilization or mental health admissions. So we're doing utilization management. We also happen to manage the mild to moderate benefit in that county. And so in preparation for this, I just did a quick analysis of our data. And so of about 111 unique admitters, 97 or 87% were health plan enrollees. And of those, 71% had a history with a mild to moderate provider, as evidenced by a paid claim by Beacon. And 53% had a paid claim within a month of that admission. And so this is a small sample size, but it's evidence that people don't sort of neatly stay in one category or the other. And it's really incumbent upon all of us to develop a more coherent system for these individuals that puts their well-being first. So I have just a couple minutes, and I'm going to offer some suggestions that I don't think require blowing everything up and starting all over, although maybe somebody wants to do that. I'm going to be a realist. There's a lot of emphasis right now around screenings, which is really great. So the childhood trauma screenings, maternal mental health screenings, screenings in general. I'm concerned these screenings are going to overwhelm a system that's already sort of strained to capacity. And so we've got to figure out different ways of providing services. Many other states have adopted large-scale psychiatric consultation programs where there's hubs of psychiatrists who are available to consult with primary care providers real-time to help them manage those populations at their level. And then also, you know, help those families or individuals navigate the system. And I think this could be a worthwhile, cost-effective investment for California. Additionally, there's not a lot of overlap between the networks between the counties and the plans. And there are some real structural issues for that, which are not easy to overcome. But I think if we could sit down and sort of look at our networks and find out like where are those providers who would be key to have in both and try to figure out how we can overcome some of those structural barriers, which usually happen to do with rates or credentialing, we could make some progress to promote continuity of care. I also think it would be interesting to explore sort of reorganizing the distribution of services or the split in certain settings, so that's not based on impairment, but based on like billable service code. So an example would be schools, where what if we decided that for all services provided in a school, the Medi-Cal health plans are going to pay for therapy, group therapy, and medication management, regardless of how sick the kid is. And then the county can pay for all of the important prevention services and then sort of more intensive case management and high intensity crisis services. Maybe we could collectively serve a greater pool of kids if we sort of blended our funding together more like that. I have to stop, but I'm going to say one last thing. That September is Suicide Prevention Awareness Month. And all payers, not just public sector payers, should really view preventing suicide and behavioral health crises as part of their scope. Not only is there tremendous human cost, but the counties aren't the only ones bearing the financial costs. If we don't intervene early, someone ends up in the emergency room or in a medical bed. Crisis systems of care, like emergency response systems, don't naturally exist in communities. They have to be built, and they must be multi-sectoral. And so developing systems that shift the focus to prevention and early intervention should not solely be the county's responsibility. We all have a role.
Thank you to the panel. I think that gave us a whole lot more context to follow on Adriana's overview. And Adriana, why don't you come up and join the rest of the group? We will have microphones in the room. They're in the back now, a couple going around. So if you are ready with your questions, please go ahead and raise your hand and a mic will come to you. But since mics are still on their way around, I actually have a few questions. And let me ask this maybe of Michelle, although other people should jump in. I think a couple of you mentioned workforce issues, and I wonder whether you want to kick us off, Michelle, by saying a little bit more about both what are the kinds of workforce challenges that your programs, the county mental health plans, face, and what are some of the things that are being done and tried?
Sure. Workforce is absolutely a problem, as you all probably know, in healthcare in general, but it's especially acute within behavioral health. As the California Healthcare Foundation helped to support and fund the Future Healthcare Workforce Commission, which pulled together a report, and it found that we'll have 41% fewer psychiatrists than we need by 2028, which feels really soon to me. And we do have an aging and a graying of the workforce. Over 45% of our psychiatrists today are over 60 years old. And so that just speaks to the impending decline there. And you know, there's a wide variation in this field in terms of which segments of the workforce serve or see which populations. And I think it's worth calling out that, again, unlike on the healthcare side, you have this pretty robust private pay system in mental health. And so when Sarah was talking about sort of the disparate rates paid between Medi-Cal managed care plan rates and counties, typically counties are paying higher rates to clinicians because our costs are, we are paid on a cost basis, and so we're able to claim fully. And so it is, you know, there are sort of challenges even within our cost-based reimbursement system in recruiting and retaining. The workforce is really strained because we're not necessarily, you know, dealing with you know, 9 to 5 all the time. You know, we need to be out and seeing people around the clock and available. Those are challenges. Our Medi-Cal population is certainly far more diverse than the pipelines that are coming out of our schools and universities. And we've got a significant maldistribution of clinicians and other behavioral health practitioners. And so, you know, we have one county in the far north, Shasta County, who's been trying for over 2 years, even with, you know, different loan forgiveness and other pots of funding, to recruit a psychiatrist, and has not been able to. And so, you know, there's just sort of the fact of, do people want to live in certain parts of the state after they've gone to, you know, a prestigious university and gotten their degree and are ready to serve? Where do they want to raise their family? And so one of the things that we have been able to do is leverage some of our Mental Health Services Act dollars at the local level to invest in workforce development projects. But you have to remember that those funds, the workforce education training dollars within MHSA, compete for other infrastructure priorities in behavioral health or mental health. So, you know, at the local decision, there are trade-off discussions, and there are, you know, it's sort of like, how can we make it appealing either to the, you know, local board or to the stakeholders that really this is the better investment? So we are really grateful to the Newsom administration, who was able to put the opportunity for $100 million under OSHPED for the statewide WET pot of money. Counties are working right now with OSHPED to come up with a 33% match for that, and then it'll be divvied up by the regional partnerships. The challenge with the match is that our MHSA dollars are in 3-year plans, basically. And so some of those plans have already been developed, but we are hopeful that we can, you know, find ways to pull together that match and really leverage those funds and use them for an initial statewide investment. I would say that is a down payment on what is needed in the long run. If we are going to build out capacity and compete with some of our better payers to the extent that they exist, you know, we often train for private coverage. We are going to have to do a lot more, and we're going to have to get creative, to Sarah's point. Do more in terms of telehealth, do more to really bring different practitioners and even unlicensed individuals into the field, and to build access out in more creative ways. But the MHSA has really been a significant driver of what investments we've made to date.
I would just say the Proposition 56 funding that was made available both in last year's budget as well as this year's budget for loan repayment, we announced the initial round of awards back in July, and it's open for physicians and dentists. And of the 247 physicians that we announced loan repayments to, approximately 40 were psychiatrists. Anecdotally, we had a psychiatrist that was preparing to move to a different state until he heard about the loan repayment program. He went from taking 0% Medi-Cal to working at an FQHC. We have several psychiatrists that we gave awards to that work for the counties in their county behavioral health delivery system. And so while that is only open to physicians, and the behavioral health system needs providers at all levels and types of scope and practicability, certainly I know psychiatrists in particular have been a pain point, as well as child psychiatrists. And so we look forward to the remaining years of the loan repayment for really targeted investment in certain key providers that we're lacking capacity in.
Thanks. Questions in the room?
Hello, I'm a mother, someone with a serious mental illness. And the one thing that I've noted is that there is supposed to be parity for severely mentally ill. The final rule is to apply to us. And yet in our welfare and institution codes, we still have that statement, to the extent resources are available. The other really serious problem for those of us who have very who have loved ones who are very seriously mentally ill is the Institute of Mental Disease Exclusion for those with a mental illness. It seems very ironic to us that they are called IMDs, Institutes of Mental Disease, and yet our loved ones are not receiving the extended 30 days just like those who have substance use disorders are. We really want to ask everyone in the room here to get behind us and to make sure that this exclusion is eliminated and that we do have parity and it's stricken from our welfare and institution codes to the extent resources are available.
Thanks. I'm going to ask Director Kent to respond to that. And can you start, Jennifer, by explaining to the whole room what IMDs are?
Yeah, sure.
Thanks.
IMDs stand for Institutes of Mental Disease. There is a federal prohibition on the availability of federal matching funds in the Medicaid program for individuals that are being treated in IMD. IMDs are anything larger than 16 beds. And if the individual is in an IMD and receiving services for a mental health condition, there is no federal funding available. This has been a longstanding topic of debate at a federal level as well as at state levels. State Medicaid programs have continuously asked for the federal government to take a look at removing that from the recognition that individuals use a continuum of services ranging from institutional care down to community treatment. And the kind of arbitrary nature of how the federal government has drawn that refusal to pay for those services in those types of facilities is really based on a fiscal calculation, right? I think that we broke that barrier for the first time when we got the drug Medi-Cal waiver, which allows for individuals to be receiving substance use disorder treatment in what are today IMDs. We did not get a waiver of the IMD statute, but what we did was we were allowed to claim over and above. It was a claiming waiver, not necessarily a waiver of the IMD provision itself. I think what the comment was really based on is the federal government released last year an opportunity for state Medicaid programs to apply for an IMD waiver for individuals with serious mental illness or serious emotional disturbance. So states have been looking at this opportunity. It is a complicated opportunity from the standpoint that there are a lot of requirements, and I know that we've been in conversations with the counties and others around, could the state apply for it? What would need to be done? How could it be done? There are some limitations on how they will allow counties, in our case, counties, to continue to provide those services and what are the conditions. And so I think what you have seen from us as a state is both the funding opportunity through the drug Medi-Cal waiver for individuals with substance use disorder. I think there's an openness for us to talk about whether we apply for that 1115 waiver opportunity. But then I would also say, when we created Whole Person Care, which is an initiative under our existing 1115 waiver, that was really, in some cases, our other attempt to try to help provide supportive housing for individuals that need a place in which they can be more closely monitored and supported as they either transition out of facilities, and that includes both IMDs as well as jails and prisons. But also to help them live as independently as possible. And so what we have done in Whole Person Care is come up with housing bundles in which individuals are able to be maintained in a housing situation and receive case management, help with their housekeeping duties, financial management, things like that. And so that is another way in which we're drawing down federal money kind of without using an IMD type of basis to help people maintain an independence in that area, but certainly defer to Michelle and other thoughts.
I just want to comment that I think that these two issues are somewhat related. And so it really goes to an existential question I think we all need to ask ourselves about the public behavioral health system, which is what is our expectation of the private insurers in California. Today, the, you know, the parity laws, as I, you know, as they exist, really speak to comparability in terms of the how you apply the benefits, but there's, it's not really necessarily setting a certain benefits level that is set to what exists in the public system. That's where you're not going to find alignment, right? What we have in behavioral health is a system on the public side that is far more robust than what exists on the private commercial side. And so, and with little financial incentive for the private insurers to do anything about it, because when that person has their first psychotic break and they end up in the hospital under a 5150, which means danger to themselves or to others, then that person becomes a part of the public behavioral health system. And that tension is even more acute because to the extent that someone is falling under that crisis end of the continuum, they also are not largely, once they get into an IMD, funded by Medi-Cal. And so it's sort of like a hot potato, not my problem situation where you have both from CMS's perspective, they're not paying for it. The private insurers aren't paying for it. And so it falls on county behavioral health to pick that up and to fund those services along with everything else we're doing. And I think what's challenging is the incentives definitely are not aligned, and we're not able to necessarily track over time that child who may have started out as a, you know, middle income or even a higher income person who gets so seriously mentally ill that they end up as the Medi-Cal childless adult, right? Because they don't have employment, because they don't, you know, they're basically disabled by virtue of their mental illness. And so there is a bigger policy question here about what are we going to do to either encourage private insurers to do more to take serious mental illness serious, or what are we going to do to help fund the public behavioral health system to grow, to expand, to meet the needs of people before they're at the point of needing to be in an IMD. And I think that that is kind of that bigger existential question that we should start to put on the table and ask ourselves.
Thanks. I think you you both answered that very well. Do we have, okay, Karen's coming with a microphone now.
Oh, you'll hold it. Thank you. I just have another question about something else, which is to Director Cabrera. Are you seeing more mobile units being utilized at a county level that are going outside of facilities and reaching people in the county, which is also aids in prevention and working with law enforcement? Is it becoming more common? I know the county where I work does have a mobile unit and it's been very effective, but I wonder, just because there's limited funds to do it also, and we're trying to be more creative to do that.
We have, I saw Toby Ewing from the MHSA OAC here earlier, but we were given funding, counties were through SB 82, and I believe that was 2013-14, someone correct me if I'm wrong, to lift up mobile crisis units in counties. And over time, those have been shifted a bit in terms of their focus. So initially, there were a lot that focused on adult populations, including homeless populations. And now we are about 50-50 children's mobile crisis, as well as adults through MHSA. And so that funding has been incredibly helpful in developing out that mobile response infrastructure. In addition, and this is a population that I didn't speak to as much, but it is another area of county behavioral health responsibility. We serve children in the child welfare system, and thanks to this year's budget, we are going to start to lift up with our child welfare partners something called Family Urgent Response System of Mobile Crisis Intervention to support children and their caregivers in at their home, so that we can try to, really stabilize children in the child welfare system and their caregivers before things escalate and kids need to go to higher levels of care. So it's a model that I think holds a lot of promise, and absolutely we should be investing more in that kind of home-based, community-based mobile support.
Are there any other funds besides MHSA funds that are going to support that?
So the Family Urgent Response System, yes.
Yeah. You know, I'm going to jump off of that to ask a question I had for you, Adriana, which was, you know, as we're thinking of this, and you laid out the primary funding streams that are there in perpetuity, but what other parts of the budget should people be looking at when they're thinking about the public behavioral health system?
That's a great question. What comes to mind is if you think of the public mental health delivery system we have and the dedicated revenue streams to fund the system as a floor and not a ceiling, you know that there's always more that can be done to increase access to mental health services or improve the quality of mental health services. As you all know, the budget cycle and the policy process for this year has just recently wrapped up, and a new one has begun. And this is a great opportunity for members of the general public, as well as stakeholders and advocates, to really promote increase in access to services and promote the improvement of quality for mental health services. Every year, as you know, the governor works with the legislature to make this possible. And one example of this, there's many examples, is related to Medi-Cal eligibility for individuals who are diagnosed with a postpartum or with a maternal mental health condition, which, as many you know, includes, but it's not limited to, pregnancy-related or postpartum depression and anxiety. And there's a bill that passed this past year and a budget allocation that would increase Medi-Cal eligibility from 60 days after giving birth to a whole year after giving birth for these individuals to continue to receive the services that they need in order to thrive. And as I mentioned, that's just one example. There's many other examples of that happening.
Thanks. Back to the room, other questions?
Hi, I just wanted to talk about the funding opportunities that are also available that she asked. So my name is Lahala Maddox. I'm the director with the Homeless Coordinating and Financing Council, and we administer the Homeless Emergency Aid Program, which is a $500 million signed into budget by Governor Brown in 2018, as well as a new $650 million program signed by Governor Newsom. So the new funding direct allocations will go to the 58 counties, as well as the continuum of care and the large cities. So with the HEAP dollars, which was the $500 million, several COCs use that funding for mobile units for both hygiene and healthcare and behavioral health. So with the new funding, the applications have not gone out yet, but some could use funding for to serve the population, because we know that homelessness and behavioral health intersects, obviously. So if you're interested in more information about that, you can visit our website, or I can leave some cards, but that is additional funding that's in the communities.
Thanks. Yeah, I think that's certainly true, that we're seeing a lot of linkages there between housing funding, housing programs, and things on the behavioral health side. So we're not even touching that particular complexity, but there's a lot. We can't see very well from up here. So, oh yeah, Crystal. Yep.
The name's Jeff Tartaglia. I advocate. And this last week, coming from the, governor's new committee on aging, Alzheimer's was mentioned, but what are you looking at as far as over 55, over 70 in mental health? And it seems like that you may have 20 counties that may have all of 100 to maybe 200 beds to deal with mental health. What resources are being delegated to those elements? San Diego County, my understanding, has even come up with a handband for identifying Alzheimer's situations. Again, what tools?
Thanks. Anyone on the panel?
I mean, I'll just say, I think that the intersection of aging and there are a few other conditions. There's Alzheimer's, traumatic brain injury, a couple of other things where there really are, opportunities for improvement across various systems. And what we're finding is that as many of our clients do live longer, even if they've been, you know, in stabilized, rehabilitated, once they get into their elder years, it does require, unfortunately, a much higher level of care. And sometimes that includes IMD levels of care, which can put a significant financial strain on the system and are not necessarily the best thing for our clients as well. And then there are folks with dementia or other conditions where it kind of becomes this this conundrum of, you know, whose area of responsibility is it? Is it easy to define? No. And so there are gaps where we do have opportunities to improve better how we're serving those individuals who fall just outside of the, you know, the scope of benefits for county behavioral health, but maybe do need something more than what they can get on their physical health plan side.
Thanks.
Cool. Can I just, I mean, and so, but that also, we didn't talk about Medicare, but a lot of individuals who are disabled because of their mental illness end up being Medi-Medis or dual eligibles. And so you mix the Medicare payment stream into this whole mix that we talked about it, and it just kind of adds another layer of complexity. And so we can't forget about Medicare. And Medicare pays for a very, very limited set of benefits.
Yeah, and I think the last numbers I saw, about a quarter of the individuals who are served in the specialty mental health system are in fact dually eligible. So they have both Medicare and Medi-Cal. So it's not, this is not a fringe issue. This is really central. So we're near the end of our time, and I'm going to take the prerogative of asking the last question, with apologies to those who didn't get their questions in. I'm just going to pose this to all of you, and you can take turns, whoever's ready first. I'm curious, sort of, what is one thing, or maybe two, if you've got two, if you can't, don't want to restrict yourselves, that you think is really a priority in the public mental health system and improving the public mental health system in the next year or next couple of years? And this could be something that your organization is particularly focused on, or something that you think this broad audience here in the room and out there in the ether should be thinking about or tracking as we move ahead. So whichever of you is ready can start. Adriana.
Well, just to expand on my earlier thought, again, there's a new budget cycle, new policy bill process that's starting as of this year, and it presents an opportunity for, as I mentioned earlier, advocates, stakeholders, members of the general public to be pushing forth increase in access to services and a increase in the quality of services. So that's just the one comment that I'd like to make.
So many microphones. So I would say a couple things. The state and the counties are getting ready to embark on the waiver renewal of our 1915B and our 1115 waiver. I think that is ripe with all kinds of good work that can be done to change the behavioral health system in the state of California. Certainly, as you saw from the presentation, so much of what the counties do to provide behavioral health services to these populations is to use different financing mechanisms. And we like to say braid the funding in order to provide whatever services the individual needs. I think there's a great opportunity to change the way that we pay counties today. And so in doing something, it sounds simple to say financing reform. It sounds simple, it's not, but it will hold the foundational change for a lot of other things that we at the state and the counties would like to accomplish. And then if I could say one other thing that would really kind of change the way the behavioral health system continues to interact with the rest of the delivery system is around stigma reduction. I think that you consistently see people either unwilling or unable or afraid to acknowledge that they have a behavioral health need, and that applies to both mental health and substance use disorder. I think that we as a state are seeing the negative outcomes of what having a behavioral health problem brings to someone in terms of they lose their job, they lose their home, they lose their family, they are unconnected from society. And I think that that is unfortunate, and that's something that we collectively have to grapple with. It touches our incarcerated population, it touches our homeless population, it touches all of these other areas that we are, you know, trying to figure out solutions to. And I think at the heart of it is really kind of addressing the stigma relating to having a behavioral health condition. And so those would be two of my main areas. And I'm not sure if I stole your thunder or not, but you've got more, I'm sure.
I've got like 20, but
two.
I'm gonna try to combine them. So I would say the first one is improving quality in our system, and that will be done through payment reform. You know, that's been a priority of our county behavioral health directors today. As I mentioned before, within Medi-Cal, cost-based, so it's fairly limited in terms of what you can do to invest. And like I said, we do get other buckets of funding outside of Medicaid, and we get very creative, and we get, you know, we've been able to do a lot with those. But we need delivery system transformation, and I don't think that's going to happen without some version of payment reform. And then the other one is improving access to our system. So that can take on many forms, but I do want to stress our partnership and our integration across multiple systems, touching various populations, whether it is children in schools or the child welfare system, working with foster youth, our justice-involved populations. So many of the people going in and out of jails and state prison are our clients, or formerly our clients, and so we do feel that connection to serve them throughout, and to really hopefully prevent them from having to get into the justice system, especially when it is inappropriate and driven by stigma. And so just those partnerships with physical health as well, making sure that we are doing a much better job of addressing the fact that our folks are underserved on the physical health side, and how we can work as better partners to make sure that we're removing those barriers to care. And I think a lot of that does go back to stigma. When Jennifer started to mention the unwillingness and the, you know, the inability, I thought she was going to talk about the delivery system, because so often it is, you know, either, you know, and it's not conscious, but it just speaks to what stigma is. There is this sense of otherness that comes with working with these populations, and I'm hopeful that we can break down some of those barriers and really have more providers who are not only willing to serve people with serious mental illness, but do it with some accountability for quality and outcomes as well.
Thanks. And Sarah, you gave us some recommendations earlier. Do you have any? Do you have another?
I have many more as well. As we think about delivery system reform and payment reform, and the group among the group that are the most challenging are the high moderates that just don't neatly fit anywhere. And they will become our seriously mentally ill if we don't help get them a different set of services at a high moderate while they're high moderates. And so I think focusing on that group earlier. And then I can't stand talking about data sharing, but it's really important. And so if we're gonna, we have to figure that out, and doing it in a way that's standard across the state would be my plea. Because if we have to have 25 or 58 different file formats, it won't happen. And so figuring out data sharing, and then figure out what we do with the data that we start sharing, and using that data to inform our service delivery, will be a really great leap forward.
Thanks. So I want to offer a big, big thanks to all of our panelists for taking the time to join us today. And I, like Sandra, also want to offer thanks both personally and on behalf of the California Healthcare Foundation to Director Kent
for her partnership over the last 5 years and her focus on behavioral health in particular among so many department priorities. So thank you, Jennifer. And to all of you who were able to join us here in person or who joined us online, thank you very much for your time. Please do look for the recording and the materials to be posted later this week, and have a good afternoon.
If you please leave your evaluations at the door, it would be very much appreciated. Your lime green evaluations at the door on your way out. Thank you.